Hey, horse people. This is a I've done a couple of videos on a couple of scenes from this show Godless on I think it's still playing on Netflix. I think this is where I'm getting it. Yeah, so it must be playing. So, this is a first of all, it's a really good series. I enjoyed it, but there's a lot of good horse scenes and there's some Hollywood kind of, this scene right here where he ends up laying a horse down. This is some really bad horse as well, and he's gonna break. So I'll give you a quick, and in case you haven't seen the series, this is a guy, he's on the run, he shows up at this lady's house. This lady lives here with her Indian son because she was raped by a bunch of Indians and she had a son. So she lives there with her with the grandmother Indian and the And when I say Indian, it's feather, not dot. So the grandmother, this is the son, and this guy shows up. So this guy's an Indian kid or half Indian, and he's kind of scared of horses. So this is his mom, and in this scene right here, this kid kind of gets interested in horses where he's been afraid before. And so this guy kind of mentors him and does a really good scene on why I say horses teach really good lessons. Horses used to be common for everybody to own and work. And to me, horses are the greatest teachers of common sense because they're not political, they're not social engineering, they don't care about your sex, your color, what church, what bathroom you use. They don't care. Horses are pure. They're a horse and that's all they know how to be. So, in this little clip here that I'm about to show and go over, he really demonstrates on how this horse can show this kid confidence, experience failure, but also experience getting back up. So this video right here, he kind of captures, he ropes this horse's leg, gets it on the ground, kind of ties it down. And of course, this is Hollywood. This isn't a good way to start a new horse. And just because you have one horse's leg, that horse can still rear charge you or drag you. But anyway, and in the end of this, he ends up laying the horse down very gently. The horse isn't sweaty. He's not sweaty. It just doesn't happen that way. But anyway, it looks good for Hollywood. Let me get to the part that is.
Bad luck for you to wear her dead son's clothes.
No, not that, Wiggy! That's a black dog, Wiggy!
Okay, so in this scene, they he bars this old woman's dead son's clothes, and he doesn't know it's an affront. And you notice he doesn't have a bit on this horse when he's starting him, which is a good thing. He's using a little bit more of a stiffer rope than I would like, but he doesn't have a bit on, and it looks like this girth strap is way forward. But anyway, I could pick apart these freaking movies all day. Anyway, so here. She gets mad. Now remember.
Wear her dead son's clothes.
No, not that, Wiggy. That's a black dog, Wiggy. Dog.
So this guy is a gunslinger. He's killed a lot of people. He's a hardened guy. But, he's a pretty nice guy and he allows this woman kind of like to vent and rage. And he doesn't fight back because he figures out, shit, I screwed up.
Easy, man.
Not that, Wiggy. Stop.
Nice duck and dodge. If you can dodge a wrench, you can dodge a ball.
Should I take them off?
It's too late. Now that you put them on, they're yours. She can't ever have them back.
Okay, so in this part right here is the scene I wanted to get to out of all my BS. He's riding this horse and he's kind of breaking it. And this little kid is watching him, and here's where the lesson starts.
He's a beauty.
Sure is. Why don't you climb up on him? It's all right, he blowed his wind. He ain't got so much oomph no more.
Okay, so that's a little saying that a lot of people will miss if you haven't worked with horses. When he's talking about he's blowed his wind or wings or whatever he said, he's basically saying he took the fight. The Indians used to break horses in the river, so the horse would buck and run and do all that, and it was hard on his feet. He didn't have good footing. He wouldn't want to buck because he didn't have good footing, and he'd get tired really quick, and if he threw you off, you're in the water. So there was a lot of benefits for starting a horse, but, I mean, it was the wrong way to start a horse. They were breaking it. They would just jump on it, hang on, cowboy up, and, you know, let it buck its way out. And that's not a good way to start a horse. It works. It's effective, and it's fast, but it's not a good foundation, and it leaves a lot of holes later. So that's what he's talking about. The horse is kind of tired now. He's ran him out. He's got all his piss and vinegar out, so he's not going to have a lot of bucking. So that's what he was talking about there.
I can't ride him. Maybe a smaller one.
Okay, so this kid, because he's been brought up by a couple women that have kind of not really been hard on him, and this is why women and men are wired differently. I know I'll have all the people, Rick, women are just as good and they don't need men, and single moms are perfect and you're just... whatever, okay? Kids need a dad for certain reasons and they need a mom for certain reasons. And it makes them more well-balanced, and they both, women and men, you know, bring out the best in both sides, and they also pull back the negative. You know, like I said, if it wasn't for women, I'd never know what holiday was coming up. I mean, women be decorating and buying in the store, selling all the Halloween and Christmas. I mean, if it wasn't for me just wandering around into, oh, shit, it must be close to Easter. Oh, it must be close to Christmas. Guys wouldn't even know. But I digress. Anyway, so he realizes that this kid is like, dude, you got to man up and start taking some chance and risk. Quit being a damn woman. Rick, women are just... oh, be quiet. Just listen or leave.
Or one that's a little older.
What kind of Indian are you? You can't ride a horse? Exactly how long you been alone with them women?
Rick, that's sexist. He can't say that. Well, unfortunately, a lot of truth in the words where people run around and try to be professional victims their whole life and find words that offend them or things that offend them. And I can be offended on anything, and it's your fault. It's everybody's fault, but my fault, because I'm offended, and offended is a right.
Long enough to forget who you are. Come on, get on it.
Now, see, some people, there'll be some women out there saying, man, this guy's kind of hard on him, this poor kid. His mom's doing the best he can. She's a single mom, and she's trying to do, and this mean man come over here and made him feel bad and told... look, kids, especially boys, need to have, you know, they got to take some risks and take some falls. And if you don't believe that, well, then you raise your kids, you know, to wear pink shirts and freaking can't figure out what bathroom to use. Anyway, I digress. Here we go. I just like to throw in these little things because I know it identifies all my weird little psycho viewers. And now they'll like freak out in the comments, and then I'll be able to block them, and then I don't have to worry about them anymore. Now, these women are a little shocked. And again, this scene to me is just very prolific in a lot of ways. It kind of just, the women are kind of like, holy shit, he got on a horse. Earlier in the series, they say he's scared of horses. And he is scared of horses. You could tell when he goes, why don't you get on? He goes, maybe one that's older, maybe one that's smaller, maybe... all these excuses that these women have been letting him get away with because they didn't want to push him. They didn't want to push him out of his comfort zone and make him man up. Rick, you can't say man up. That's sick. And that women could be just, oh, shut up, you freak. I'm so tired of women running around trying to be men, telling everybody, good grief. Anyway, so I digress. So this guy's teaching his kid good lesson, and even the women recognize that, holy shit, he got on a horse, which is good. Making him grow.
All right, take him around the fence. You the boss of that animal, son, or is he the boss of you?
Okay, this is a common thing with horses. Show the horse who's boss, etc. There's a much deeper philosophy into this, people. You can't just get on a horse and manhandle. I mean, you can, and it works on some horses, and you just use brutal force. You put on big spurs, and you stick him in his ribs. You put on a big bit, and you yank his mouth around and cause pain. Some horses have learned over time to just go ahead and submit when they get a jerk on their back. But, you know, the old saying, the horse stopped with a jerk, and the jerk fell off. Well, if you can, you can be a jerk, but you need to understand a horse. And when people hear these little sayings, sometimes they take it to the extreme. Are you the boss, or is the horse a boss? He's telling a guy, look, you got to let him know what you want to do. You got to be a little bit more assertive. You can't be weak and milquetoast and begging and nagging and asking 1,000 times with words, because horses don't have language. They don't speak with words. They do use body language. They use feeling. They use emotion about how you're doing and how you make them feel and how they feel around you, whether it's safe or fearful. So when he said this statement, a lot of people will be like, see, Rick, you're always saying don't show the horse who's boss. And now he just said it and he's a man. And that ain't it. You're a freaking idiot. Quit trying to double talk your way into your ignorance.
You the boss of that animal, son, or is he the boss of you? There you go.
Okay, so you notice he didn't have to kick and get mean. He just got a little more assertive. He gave the horse better clues and better cues as to what he wanted. Before, the horse wasn't being stubborn or mean. He was just like, dude, you're sitting on my back. What am I supposed to do? He didn't know what to do. Now, if this guy wouldn't be fanning and making this horse move, this kid would sit on him, like I see a lot of, let's just say a lot of people that wear pink, like to sit on a horse and let it walk, and they don't want to challenge it, and they're afraid when it runs because it's too fast, and they're afraid they can't stop it, and they're afraid they don't have control, and then they'll blame the horse for not having brakes, and the horse doesn't respect the bit, and this horse is stupid, and the horse is a runaway, and I have to practice my emergency. All this craziness in the horse world that it just doesn't make no damn sense to me. But, you know, things that don't make sense to somebody that knows seem very rational and normal to somebody that doesn't know.
There you go. Don't be kicking him too much. That just nettles him.
Wow, that's a great tip. Don't just kick him too much because it metals him. I call that nagging. When people get on a horse and they nag the shit out of it, they're kicking. They have loud feet. Loud feet means active movings, always talking. When somebody says loud hands or loud feet or loud body, it's not loud verbally like me. It's loud with your body. You can't sit still. Your cues, you don't give good, clear direction. You give constant nagging. Your hands are always moving, so the horse tends to ignore them. Your legs are always kicking, so the horse tends to ignore them. What do? You think the answer is, if I kick harder, if I kick more, if I kick longer. If a horse won't listen to my hands, I'll move my hands more. I'll shake the bit. I'll make him. It's exact opposite. You have desensitized the horse and made him ignore, kind of like somebody that just talks at you, nags, nag, 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 nag. You tune him out. The old Charlie Brown, the school teacher. Wah, 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 wah. That's all you hear. That's what the horse hears in body language when your hands are loud and moving all the time. When you don't control them and keep them in this nice box and keep them quiet. When I say quiet hands, that means still, not moving a lot, not jerky hands. Smooth, slow, consistent movements. That's quiet hands.
Squeeze him with your legs. Good.
I gotta go back to those
your legs.
Because there we go, sorry. Oops, too far.
There you go. Don't be kicking him too much. That just nettles him. Squeeze him with your legs.
So this movie was made back in the day to where women understood that it was okay to be a woman and it's okay to be a man, and we're different and we do things different. Even they find joy in seeing a young boy progressing, taking risk, and doing things that a boy should do. Even they recognize it. Even though they couldn't do it, they recognize that it's good for the boy. Rick, you're just... Shut up, freaking crybabies.
Good.
Okay, I want you to notice his toes are pointing down. Remember, when your toes point down, your body will soon follow. If your toes point to the ground, your body's going to follow and you'll be on the ground soon. This means people are off balance. They're not what I call deep in a seat or sitting up. He's leaning forward and he's got his toes down. Now, I'm assuming this guy knows how to ride and he's doing this on purpose for the movie. But he does a good job because this is exactly when you see people riding with their toes pointing down. This is what happens. Okay, got off the phone. Here we go. Toes down. Toes down.
There you go.
No more mules for you, cowboy.
Hey, Mom.
Good. Okay, so the kid right now is feeling confident, pride. He's like, look, Mom, I'm riding. He's running. Check it out. So he's building pride in this kid, which is a good thing. And this horse is about to teach him a hard lesson. Remember, the hardest thing about riding a horse is the ground.
Whoa.
Okay, I told a story where I had one of my girlfriends ride Mr. T and he threw her off like this. And I went immediately to the horse just like he did. He didn't go to this kid. He went to the horse. And another girl that was watching it gave me shit. It's like, Rick, man, your girlfriend's on the ground over there. You went to check on Tanner. I go, I didn't go check on Tanner. I wanted to make sure that he didn't run over her and control him. But it looks like this mean man is ignoring this poor kid who fell on the ground and he just cares about the horse. Well, shit. I know this guy's position. Anyway, I know all the women out there are like, oh, that poor kid, he should go help him. What? There goes the women. They're running over to help and save. This is a great, like I said, whoever did this scene, I mean, they just captured so much. They are going to run over and save this kid and watch this guy. Don't come in. Great scene.
Get yourself up.
Get back on him. Get back on him now.
Grab him by that jaw rope and climb back on top of him.
Okay, so a lot of people will think this is hard and this is mean and you should check the kid and maybe he's hurt. And Rick, maybe he's, if he'd had a helmet on and if we had bubble wrap around him and if he had a bulletproof vest on and if he had, you know, leggings that would protect, he would have been safe. And this is just cruel and mean and you should never do this to a kid. And this is, to me, what's ruining freaking kids now. Is this overprotection safety. If it's not parents protecting the shit out of kids, it's government protecting the shit out of everybody. And nobody has to learn a lesson. Nobody has to experience failure and be able to push through and fight, gain confidence, and then be able to get back on a horse and do it. You know, the saying is still around, get back on a horse. When a horse knocks you down, get back on him. Because it still holds true to Jay. When you fail, you got to get up and stay in the game. You just can't quit every time you fail or you're going to be a professional quitter. But anyway, this guy pushes him good, I think. I'm sure a lot of people will disagree that he's being testosterone man.
I don't want to.
If you don't, he ain't ever going to respect you. Worse than that, you ain't ever going to respect yourself.
Bingo. That's the problem. That's the big problem. People don't respect themselves. They don't respect anybody else. That's why we have such a freaking crazy... ignorant society right now.
Now go on. Get back up there, and this time, keep him under you.
Okay, so he tells him to keep the horse under him. There's another old saying that said, hey, riding's easy. All you got to do is keep the horse between you and the ground. And, that holds true no matter how you say it. You've got to keep the horse underneath you. And you do that by staying balanced, keeping your center of gravity low. Keeping your toes or heels down and not letting your toes get forward, not getting forward on the horse, staying back. It's a lot easier to take. If you watch any of the bucking horse people that ride bulls and bucking, they almost lay down on the horse's back. Their back is almost laying down on the horse's back. And you should take that as a clue, because if you want to stay on a horse, you got to keep your body lean back. If the horse gets you forward, you're toast. And I talk from experience, because I've gotten my body forward several times on horses. Most of the time, it was probably my fault. A couple times, horses were just so good at bucking so quick and twisted so much that, damn, it was hard to stay back. And next thing you know, before you know it, you're forward. And you're like, how the hell did I get here? Next thing you know, you're on the ground. Well, you're in the air first, then you're on the ground. So I'm speaking from experience. You got to keep your heels down. By keeping your heels down, you force your legs forward. By forcing your legs forward, you force your back and your shoulders backwards. That's how you stay on a horse when the ride gets rough. And when I say the ride gets rough, that means when he's bucking like this kid. What a cute little horse. He's like, dude, I didn't do nothing. I'm just riding around and shit. Why are you guys all upset? What's going on? What a cute horse.
Go on, get a hold of him. Don't let him decide.
Another great tip. Don't let him decide. See, before, when you, if you try to round pin a horse in a huge pasture, it doesn't work, because the horse can decide to relieve the pressure and run away from you. And by the time you catch him, he'll run away again. And by the time you get to him, he'll run away again. So when you put him in a round pin and you control his movement, the horse can't decide when you stop putting pressure. You decide. Unfortunately, most people don't know when to stop pressure and when to let the horse know what the right answer is. But the purpose of a round pin is so I can decide when I get the right answer, when I get the right response from a horse, I can decide when to stop the pressure. The horse cannot decide. The horse can run all day, and he'll run in circles, and he will never relieve the pressure of me. That's the theory and principle behind the round pin. There's no corner for him to run and get trapped. All he can do is run, and pretty soon the horse figures out, damn, I can't run away from this guy. That's why when you work with a horse and he gets away and he runs away, you set back your training tremendously, because the horse just learned, ah, this is how I relieve the pressure. This is how I get away. So by him telling him, don't let him decide, that's kind of the bigger theory behind that.
Boy, now give him his head.
Okay, when he said give him his head, real important. When most people get on a horse and they're scared, what do? That's why I said whoever did the technical stuff on this was really good. There was a lot of great horse scenes in here. There's some bad ones, but there's a lot of great ones. When he says give him his head, that means relax the reins. Most people get on a horse that just threw him and they're scared. They're tight. They're tense. They're pulling on that reins and they lock this horse's head up. Guess what? That makes the horse tense. That makes the horse scared. A horse is a reflection of the rider. If you're scared, tense, and pulling, the horse is going to be scared, tense, and pulling. A horse is a mirror of the person handling it. That's where these sayings come from. People say them, but they don't really understand the depth of how true they really are.
There you go.
Now, he let this horse get a little fast, but this tells me right here by looking at this that the guy riding him understands that. So they might have put him on a little bit of a hot horse, but what did this guy do that tells me he understands this horse is a little hot and about to run off? If you said he's not running the fence line and letting him run the fence, he turned him to make the circle smaller. A horse can't run as fast when he's going smaller. Now, I like a bigger round pin to work with. I don't like small round pins. To me, are a cheat. Anybody can round pin, and it's very hard for a horse to relieve pressure and for you to release pressure. In a large round pin, I can put pressure on a horse, and I can walk all the way to the other side. I can make the horse follow me, connect up, and make that draw and make him follow me a long distance to where he doesn't feel trapped. Small round pins, you can't do that. You're always putting pressure. So to me, inexperienced people, and usually people that don't understand, work with small round pins because it's easier. And people are normally lazy and they always take the easy route. And the easy way is usually the hard way for horses. The easy way is never the fast way because you have to repeat it and you don't understand the long-term consequences by being easy and taking shortcuts. Small round pins, shortcuts, and easy. Now, small round pins nowadays because of money. Costs a lot of money to have a bigger round pin. I love these old wooden round pins. But anyway, I digress. Here we go.
Don't haul back on that rope. Keep your heels down so we don't unload you.
Unload you means kick or throw you off.
Haul him back, boy.
Whoa.
Stay on him.
Okay, so right here, this kid leans on the inside, which is kind of common. He starts going this way. Centrifugal force pulls you this way, and riders tend to overcompensate and lean in. And so they lean inward. You would think the person would fall this way. Well, people are so afraid of that wall, and they lean in, they end up losing their balance this way. Had he stayed forward right here, he probably wouldn't have lost it.
Keep your heels down so we don't unload you.
So he's throwing a few bucks here. His legs, this guy's getting forward. See him leaning forward on his head. Notice the horse is leaning inward because he's running this way. So the rider's leaning inward. So it doesn't take much to lean a little too far this way and you lose your balance, which is what happens right here. Leaning in. Now, I think it was for the movie, and this was what I called a stuntman dismount or, you know, intentional fall. Now, right about now, Mom's like, this is just too much. He's failed twice. He's going to get hurt. I need to stop this. I needed to save my child before this mean man kills him. Whatever.
Come on, get up.
No.
Get back on him.
So, he saw the kid give up, and he kind of gave up and walked away. Now, this is kind of a little psychological, you know, let him fail, make him feel bad. This kid kind of likes him and respects him. He's got kind of a man figure around, so he's using that to kind of embarrass the kid. So, the kid's going to be like, wait a minute, I like you. I don't want you to not like me. And he uses that great scene. Embarrassment, fear, all this kid's learning. Failure, how to stay in a fight, how to get back on, how not to get beat. Life is a constant battle. And when we raise kids to give up, take the easy way, and to cry victim, and I want my own freaking bathroom because I don't know which one to use. I mean, it's just freaking crazy. So the kid went back because he's stubborn, because he's a boy, because he's a kid. And he's like, you know what? I'm not going to let this guy walk away and think that I can't do this. I'm going to do it. So he pushed him to grow, and this horse is making him grow. That's what I'm saying. Horses, this horse isn't throwing him because he doesn't like him. He's not throwing him because he's an Indian. I'm sure somebody will be out there saying, oh, this is unfair. They're making it look like Indians can't ride. They were the best horsemen. This movie is racist. There'll be all kind of names on why, you know, nobody can learn anything anymore. You can't learn anything because there's so many obstacles on, you know, how bad everything is and how many words we can come up with to find to be offended. Okay, very classical for people to get on a horse that's run away and they don't tighten up the rein. Again, this is the movie and they made it, but this is a very, this happens 100 times. You get on a horse that's ran off or that's careful, you better have this rope tight so you can tilt his head. This rope is what we call gave the horse his head, and that's why this horse took off. Now, he did it on purpose for the movie, and they told him to do it, and this is staged. But to me, it happens unknowingly 1,000 times a day with horses. If you get on a horse that's flighty, bucky, or running away and give you a hard time, that head has to be turned so he can't take off, so he knows that you have control of him. Until, remember they said earlier, give him his head. Well, he never took his head, so he can't give it to him. The horse already has it. Let go of the rope. Another important lesson. Now, in this case, he's in a round pen. He's staying in here. I mean, and I've got plenty of rope burns where I didn't let go of the rope. But if a horse is dragging you in an open area, you can let go of the rope. I mean, you just catch him, especially in a round pen. But for movie's sake, he's going to get hurt and dragged around a little bit. So not only is the kid building confidence and getting better, the horse is realizing that the kid isn't going to give up and the kid's not a pushover. And the kid isn't going to just go braid his tail and groom him and braid his mane and give him a cookie. The horse is learning that maybe this guy is a leader. Maybe I can listen to this guy. Maybe he won't get me killed. Maybe he's not a pushover. Rick, you're just picking on Pete. Be quiet, little cookie people.
Whoa, easy now. Easy, boy.
You notice he put him by the wall there? Now see, an inexperienced person wouldn't do that. I caught this as a movie or as a horse guy. He made that horse face that wall so he could get on him so he couldn't take off because he's facing the wall. And he's got a little bit tighter rope on him this time. Now that was a bad lesson. You never let a horse just run off when you get on him. Otherwise he learns, every time you get on me, I'm supposed to run off. So you always want to make a horse stand for a couple seconds when you get on. Unless... I know somebody's going to be here. Well, in your video when you said you're starting, you said you never just want to sit on a horse. Well, that's because you're an idiot. You can't tell the difference between when I'm talking about a new horse that you're starting versus a horse that you ride regularly. You don't let a horse run off for routine. Now, when you're getting a starting a horse, you get on him. The last thing you want to do is just sit on him because then he gets nervous. He's fearful. You're on his back and then he'll end up blowing up. So, you know, everybody wants to come here and try to compare apples and oranges. Well, you said this and you said this and you're not talking. Shut, you big crybabies.
Good boy. He's your horse now.
Okay, so I thought that was a great scene. I know it went long, but a lot of lessons in this little thing. You know, the problem with the movies is they kind of show bits and pieces. And of course, you know, they're telling a story, so they don't want to be stopping it and explaining it. But as a horseman, as somebody that understands horses, you should be able to tell the difference between the cues that the person is giving, even though they're doing horse stunts like that. This guy is a pretty good horseman, or he had a pretty good trainer, because he knew how to control the horse when he had to, and he knew how to let the horse go so he could fall off, etc. So, overall, pretty good. I don't like a buckle on a horse. I don't like straps that are flapping when a horse is running. This is flapping. Not a fan of all that. But anyway, all right, we'll end that there. Y'all have a good day. The whiners can cry in the comments so I can block you. Thank you. All right, we'll end that there. Buddy Bustee, you're good boys.